Hello, dear students. Today we are going to conduct the mock test discussion which we have just conducted on the cardiovascular system and diuretics. Okay. So the first question which is asked in the mock test, ventricular remodeling after myocardial infarction involves the mediation of angiotensin II, prostaglandin, bradykinin, and thromboxane A2. Answer is angiotensin II. As you know, it's very simple. It causes the hypertrophy and hyperplasia of the myocardial cells and also responsible for pathological remodeling. The second question is captopril, which is an ACE inhibitor. It produces the greater fall in the blood pressure in. Out of the available options, the correct option is diuretic treated patient. Because when the diuretic and captopril are given in combination, they will cause the fall in the diuretic will cause fall in the sodium, which in turn causes the increase in the renin activity. And more the increase in the renin activity, more will be the generation of angiotensin 1 and then the subsequent inhibition of ACE inhibitor by captopril. So the correct answer is A, diuretic treated patient. Third question is potentiation of bradykinin appears to play a role in the following effects of S inhibitor except. So the correct answer is fall in the BP in the long term, which is the B, because rest of all three options, so bradykinin breakdown is prevented by S inhibitor. Okay, so bradykinin is a potential vasodilator, so it will cause the fall in the blood pressure in the short term because of vasodilatation action, as well as bradykinin is responsible for the cough and the angioedema. But in the long term, this increase in the bradykinin does not appear to have a significant role, because apart from kininase 2 or ACE, which is the enzyme responsible for degradation, it is also degraded by kininase 1, which is not inhibited by ACE inhibitor. So in the long term, fall in the blood pressure is not going to be affected. Okay. So the correct answer is here, fall in the BP in the long term. Rest all three, they are done by the bradykinin increase. Fourth one, enalapril differs from captopril in the following features except. This is very commonly asked and it's a very clear cut. All the three options are correct except C option. It acts more rapidly. No, enalapril acts more slowly as compared to the captopril. While A option, it is dose to dose more potent. Yes, enalapril is more potent than captopril. That's why required in the less dose. Enalapril absorption is not affected by food in the stomach. Yes, it is correct. And it has a longer duration of action. Fifth question is, advantages of ACE inhibitor as antihypertensive include the following except. So ACE inhibitor have all the three advantages A, C, D except answer is the B. Their efficacy is not reduced by non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug or NSAID. This is wrong. Actually, ACE inhibitor efficacy is reduced by NSAIDs or endomethacin type of the drugs, because they can cause the salt and water retention, which will reduce the efficacy of ACE inhibitor, because salt and water retention will further contribute to the increase in the blood pressure. So that will reduce the efficacy. While ACE inhibitor, they can reverse the left ventricular hypertrophy or pathological remodeling. That's why they are more beneficial. They do not worsen the lipid profile and they do not impair the work performance. Okay. Next question is clinically, the angiotensin antagonist or AT1 receptor antagonist share the following features of ACE inhibitor except. So the answer is D, potential to induce the cough in susceptible individuals, because both of them have antihypertensive efficacy, both of them are going to reverse the left ventricular hypertrophy or pathological remodeling, and both of them have a lack of effect on carbohydrate tolerance, so safer in a diabetic patient. But the bradykinin increase, which is done by ACE inhibitor and responsible for cough and angioedema, is not caused by the AT1 receptor antagonist, because they are not inhibiting the ACE enzyme, they are inhibiting the AT1 receptor on which angiotensin 2 is going to act. So they will not cause the cough and angioedema, and this is the advantages of losartan type of the drugs or ARB. Next is positive inotropic action of digoxin takes several hours to develop. So the here D option is correct, which is both A and B are correct. You know, digoxin is the cardiac glycoside which is given in the patient of congestive heart failure, and it inhibits the sodium potassium ATPase in the myocardial cell. But the action of digoxin takes several hours because of these two reasons. Binding of digoxin to the sodium potassium ATPase is very slow. Second, after the sodium potassium ATPase inhibition, the sodium is not extruded outside and the calcium loading occurs within the inside the myocardial cell. But this calcium loading of myocardial fibers occurs progressively, not rapidly. So it occurs gradually with each contraction. That's why digoxin action takes time to develop. That's why we are giving the loading dose first in order to produce the rapid action. Answer is D. Question number 8. This is a very clear-cut question. Most important channel of elimination of digoxin, the answer is A, glomerular filtration. So it is clearly mentioned that digoxin is primarily excreted unchanged by the kidney through the glomerular filtration. Next question, 9 number, potassium therapy tends to counteract the cardiac toxicity of digitalis. Here the answer D is correct, both A and B. So first A, reducing the affinity of sarcolemmal sodium potassium ATPase for digitalis. So binding of digitalis to the sodium potassium ATPase is decreased in the presence of potassium. Second, potassium suppresses the ectopic automaticity which is enhanced by the digitalis. So these two answers are correct. That's why D is the answer. Question number 10, select the most appropriate suitable antiarrhythmic drug for counteracting the ventricular extrasystoles due to digitalis toxicity, and the answer here is lignocaine. Okay, so for ventricular extrasystoles or ventricular tachycardia caused by digitalis toxicity, lignocaine is a drug of choice, while for the AV block, atropine is considered. Next question, 11 number, following drug given concurrently can enhance the toxicity of digoxin, and the answer is quinidine. Okay, because it decreases its renal and biliary clearance, and that's why double the level of digoxin which will be responsible for its toxicity. Next question, dose of digoxin in CHF is adjusted by monitoring. So out of the available option, the answer B is correct, heart rate and symptoms of CHF. The digoxin will produce the decrease in the heart rate and it will cause the improvement in the symptoms of the CHF. So rather than ECG or plasma digoxin level or blood pressure, the useful guide for adjusting the dose is heart rate and symptoms of the CHF. When there is a reduction in heart rate and relief in the symptoms of the CHF, we can reduce the dose of digoxin in order to avoid the possible toxicity of digoxin. Next question, long-term maintenance therapy with digoxin is best option in following category of CHF patient. The answer here is C, patient with associated atrial fibrillation, because digoxin is responsible for control of ventricular rate in a patient of atrial fibrillation and atrial flutter, as it delay the AV conduction. Okay, so when a CHF is associated with atrial fibrillation, digoxin is preferred, and other options it is not preferred. Coming to the question number 14, following action of digoxin is responsible for beneficial effect in atrial fibrillation. I just mentioned in the previous question, the answer here is a C, that is depression of AV conduction. The digitalis causes the delay in AV conduction, because of which the atriae which are contracting at very fast rate in the atrial fibrillation, almost 400 to 500, these impulses are not passed down to the ventricles because AV conduction is delayed by digitalis. And remember, though the atria are contracting at a very high rate, 400 to 500, that is not going to be that much harmful for the patient as compared to the ventricular contracting at the same rate. So we have to decrease mainly the rate of ventricles. Okay. Next question, select the drug that can help restore the cardiac performance as well as prolong the survival in CHF patients. So you have to select the drug which have both the things, that is it can restore the cardiac performance, means can give the symptomatic relief as well as it can prolong the survival. Answer here is D, metoprolol. I will explain. A, spironolactone, it will cause the prolongation of survival in the CHF patient by altering the pathological remodeling, but it will not restore the cardiac performance. While furosemide, which is a high saline diuretic, it can reduce the symptoms by reducing the preload and edema, but it will not prolong the survival. While dobutamine, which is a positive inotropic, it can restore the cardiac performance by increasing the inotropic action, but it will not prolong the survival. While metoprolol, which is a selective beta 1 blocker, it will reduce the symptom and restore the cardiac performance. At the same time, it can prolong the survival by reducing the pathological remodeling. Next question, which vasodilator is most suitable for a patient of CHF who is symptomatic even at a rest and has a central venous pressure of 25 mm of Hg and cardiac index 1.8 liter per minute per square meter. So this clearly indicate that is a patient having a grade 4 type of the NYHA grade 4 type of the congestive heart failure, and here the preload is very highly raised. Central venous pressure is highly raised, in the other words, preload is highly raised. So, considering hydralazine and nifedipine, they are arterial dilator, they are not preferred, and out of which glyceryl trinitrate and enalapril, we want the combined dilator and one who is also going to reverse the pathological remodeling. So, though both are the combined arterial and venodilator, if we have to select the most suitable, we will go with enalapril, as apart from causing preload and afterload reduction, that is venodilatation and afterload reduction, it will cause the reversing of pathological remodeling. Next question, beneficial effect of beta blockers in CHF include the following except. So the answer here is B, antagonism of vasoconstriction due to sympathetic overactivity. We will see other three options. So, antagonism of ventricular wall, stress enhancing action of sympathetic overactivity. Yes, this is done by beta blocker. They will antagonize this ventricular wall. They will prevent the pathological remodeling of ventricular myocardium, and at the same time, they can be responsible for prevention of dangerous cardiac arrhythmia. But beta blocker will not antagonize the vasoconstriction because beta receptors are vasodilatory, and we are actually inhibiting the receptor, beta receptor. So they will contribute to the vasoconstriction. So they will not antagonize the vasoconstriction due to sympathetic overactivity. That is the answer here. Question number 18. Choose the correct statement about use of beta blockers in CHF. So there are the certain guidelines which are given in the use of beta blockers in the CHF. Out of available option, the correct one is C. They are most useful in mild to moderate cases with systolic dysfunction due to dilated cardiomyopathy. First, we will see all beta blockers are equally effective. No, only certain like carvedilol, metoprolol and bisoprolol are effective, while propranolol may worsen the CHF. So this is a wrong statement. They are used as an alternative to conventional therapy with ACE inhibitor plus digitalis or diuretic. No, they are useful as an add-on to the conventional therapy. Okay. And they are indicated only in asymptomatic left ventricular dysfunction. There is no role of beta blocker in asymptomatic left ventricular dysfunction. So the correct answer is C. Next question. Select the drug which is ionodilator, beneficial in refractory CHF. This is a very clear-cut and common predicted question. Answer is C, ambrinone. As you know, ambrinone is a phosphodiesterase 3 inhibitor, so it will increase in the cyclic AMP level, so it will cause iono, means increase in inotropic action, and dilatation means vasodilatation. So increase in cyclic AMP will cause increase in cardiac inotropic action as well as vasodilatation. So answer is ambrinone C. Next question, following apply to the use of spironolactone in CHF except. So the all the other A, B, C, they are the correct answers, while D, it affords rapid symptomatic relief. We have also seen in the previous question, spironolactone will cause prolongation of survival, but it will not afford rapid symptomatic relief in CHF patient. Rest all three are correct. It is indicated only in NOHA class 3 or 4 cases as additional drug to conventional therapy. Yes, it is used as an add-on therapy to ACE inhibitor and other drugs, not as a sole or a monotherapy. It upholds the prognostic benefit in severe CHF over and above that afforded by ACE inhibitor. Yes, because it reduces the pathological remodeling by antagonism of aldosterone, and it helps to overcome the refractoriness to the diuretics. Next question, following drug is used to reduce the frequency of angina pectoris as well as to terminate an acute attack. So isosorbate dinitrate A is the answer. It is useful for acute attack of angina as well as by the sublingual route and for reducing the frequency of angina and for a chronic prophylaxis. The rest three drugs, they are useful only for the pentaethyl and diltiazem, they are useful for prophylaxis, but dipyridamole is not preferred. Next question, choose the correct statement about the action of nitrate on coronary vessels. So out of which the answer which is correct is B. They preferentially dilate the conducting arteries, that is a bigger coronary arteries, without affecting the resistance arterioles. Okay. This option C, which can be confusing to some student, they preferentially dilate autoregulatory arterioles without affecting the larger artery. This is wrong. They causes the dilatation of larger arteries or larger coronary arteries, because of which the blood flow to the ischemic area is particularly increased without much affecting to the other non-ischemic areas. Question number 23, organic nitrates have predominantly venodilator action because the answer which is correct is B. Veins express larger quantities of enzyme that generate the nitric oxide from nitrates. You know, nitrates causes the reduction in the preload by causing the venodilatation, and venodilatation through the nitrates is achieved by the conversion of nitrate into nitric oxide through the enzyme mitochondrial aldehyde dehydrogenase, which is selectively expressed in the veins. That's why nitrates have venodilators. The rest, they are selectively concentrated in the veins is wrong, and the veins has a greater capacity to relax is also not proper in this scenario. So answer is D. Yeah, answer D is also not correct, because one may have a tendency to mark D in these type of the questions. Answer is B. Question number 24, select the organic nitrate which undergoes minimum phosphatabolism in the liver. Sure shot answer, isosorbate bononitrate. No need for expression, little phosphatabolism. Nitrate tolerance is least likely to develop with the use of. Yes, this is a very commonly asked question on nitrate tolerance in the most of the PG exam also for MCQ purpose. Whenever you are giving the nitrate and when the nitrate is present for the long time in the body, you are going to develop the nitrate tolerance. But whenever the nitrate is present for the short period, the chances of development of tolerance are less. When you are giving sublingual glycerol dinitrate, it is acting very rapidly and eliminated also very rapidly. So the chances of development of tolerance are less. While sustained release oral glycerol dinitrate, transdermal and oral pentaerythritol, these are acting very slowly and nitrate will remain in the body for the longer time. So this will have a higher chances of development of tolerance. So answer is B, sublingual glycerol trinitrate. Select the drug which can markedly potentiate the vasodilator action of organic nitrates. Out of the available options, the option D, sildenafil, is correct, because sildenafil is the phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitor which is given in the pulmonary hypertension and in the erectile dysfunction. It causes the increase in cyclic GMP level, which will cause the vasodilatation. So vasodilatation caused by sildenafil will add to that caused by nitrates, and that will causes the marked potential of vasodilatation and fall in the blood pressure. So these two drugs should be avoided giving together, nitrates and sildenafil. Next question, antidotal effect of sodium nitrate in cyanide poisoning is dependent upon? The answer which is correct here is C, conversion of hemoglobin to methemoglobin by sodium nitrate. As you know, apart from the usual uses of nitrate in the angina, CHF and MI, it is also given in the cyanide poisoning because sodium nitrate is responsible for conversion of hemoglobin to methemoglobin. Once it is converted, then this methemoglobin has a very high affinity with cyanide radical. Then cyanomethemoglobin is formed and then we can give the sodium thiosulfate after that, which can make this more soluble. But the answer we are asking here in the question, they are asking about sodium nitrate. So conversion of hemoglobin to methemoglobin is the most important for the rest of the things to happen. So C is answer. Next is, which of the following drug is most likely to accentuate the variant or Prinz metal angina? The answer is propranolol, because propranolol is non-selective beta blocker and it will not cause the blockade of alpha receptor. So because of blockade of both beta 1 and beta 2 receptor, the coronary vasodilatation which is actually useful, that is blocked, and at the same time alpha receptors are not blocked, so alpha receptor mediated coronary constriction can happen. And you know, in the pathology, in the Prinz metal of variant angina is coronary vasospasm. So by giving the propranolol, we are going to accentuate that coronary vasospasm. So it should be not be given in variant angina. Answer is propranolol. Rest all the drugs, they are not going to accentuate. Actually, they are going to benefit the variant angina, especially atenolol and verapamil. Next question, following calcium channel blocker is specifically indicated to counteract the cerebral vasospasm and neurological sequelae following the subarachnoid hemorrhage. The answer here is B, that is nimodipine, because it is highly lipid soluble drugs and have a very selective action to relax the cerebral vasculature. That's why nimodipine as a calcium channel blocker is preferred in hemiplegia or in neurological stroke where the cerebral vasospasm is have happened. Next question, following anti-anginal drug is most likely to produce tachycardia as a side effect. Okay, here the all these are calcium channel blocker. The diltiazem and verapamil, actually they produces the bradycardia because they inhibit the SA node as well as AV node. Okay, mainly the depression of SA node. Nifedipine is a dihydropyridine and it is very rapidly acting. So first, what it will cause? It will cause the rapid reduction in the blood pressure, because of which there is a reflex increase in the baroreceptor mediated action and reflex sympathetic activity, which will predominantly cause tachycardia. And remember, nifedipine action is predominant on blood vessels while action on the heart is very negligible. That's why nifedipine will produce reflex tachycardia due to its rapid action. Answer is B, nifedipine. Next, which of the following is not an attribute of amlodipine? The sure short answer is A, generation of active metabolite. Amlodipine itself is active. It does not need to be converted into active metabolite. Rest all, they are the pharmacokinetic characteristics of amlodipine: large volume of distribution, high and consistent oral bioavailability, long elimination half-life. Okay, so this is a very characteristic CCB which you have to remember. Propranolol should not be prescribed for a patient of angina pectoris who is already receiving the drugs on nifedipine, pilodipine, verapamil and isosorbide bononitrate. Answer here is C, verapamil, because propranolol causes the bradycardia as well as it causes the depression of AV conduction, depression of conduction velocity, and at the same time verapamil also causes the sinus bradycardia and the decrease in the conduction velocity of AC and AV node. So both of them, if they are given together, they will result in the additional atrioventricular block. Okay, so they should be avoided giving together as both of them are causing decrease in heart rate or bradycardia. Which of the following drug is potassium channel opener? Very sure short answer is A, nicorandil. Hydralazine is the arterial dilator. Glibenclamide is actually potassium channel blocker. which is a oral hypoglycemic, while amiloride is a diuretic which is inhibitor of renal epithelium sodium channel. So nicorandil is a potassium channel opener. Next, coronary still phenomenon has been noted most frequently. The answer is here B, dipyridamole. Very commonly asked question. Dipyridamole, it causes the dilatation of autoregulatory resistant vessels in non-ischemic zone also, apart from ischemic zone. That's why blood flow gets diverted from ischemic area to non-ischemic area, and that will further aggravate the angina symptoms. So coronary still phenomenon, answer is dipyridamole. Higher incidence of MI and increased mortality has been noted with which of the following antihypertensive drug? So out of which the A, nifedipine is the answer, because nifedipine, as I explained earlier also, is a rapidly acting dihydropyridine type of calcium channel blocker which will cause reduction in the blood pressure very drastically, because of which reflex increase in tachycardia and reflex increase in cardiac contractility happens. That will, in a patient of MI, this will be dangerous and it is responsible for higher chances of death or mortality. Answer is A, nifedipine. Question 36. Choose the most suitable antihypertensive drug for a 45-year-old male company executive who is having a traveling job. His blood pressure is 160 by 100. You can say a grade 2 hypertension, and is a diabetic who is controlled with glibenclamide 5 mg twice a day. Glibenclamide, as you know, is an oral hypoglycemic sulfonylurea. So patient is diabetic, apart from he has a hypertension. A very sure shot answer, a patient with hypertension and blood pressure, drugs which are preferred are S inhibitor. Here S inhibitor is B, enalapril. So propranolol, clonidine and hydrochlorothiazide, both all these three, they are not preferred for the patient of diabetes with hypertension. Clonidine is given in diabetes, but for the another reason, that is for the diabetic gastropathy type of the symptoms, okay, or diarrhea which is associated with diabetic neuropathy. But enalapril is preferred because S inhibitor, they reduces the chances of diabetic nephropathy by reducing the proteinuria or albuminuria in the patient of diabetes. Most likely mechanism of antihypertensive action of thiazide diuretics in the long term is, the answer here is D, reduction in the total peripheral vascular resistance or TPR and improved compliance in resistance vessels, that is arterioles. So though they will reduce the circulating blood volume, but this is not useful, is going to be in the long term, because reduction in the blood volume further will cause increase in the renin, which will further activate the renin angiotensin system and will cause salt and water retention. But the sodium deficiency, which is caused by the diuretics, that will reduce the total peripheral resistance, and that will be responsible for the decrease in the blood pressure in the long term. So answer is D. Furosemide is preferred over hydrochlorothiazide when hypertension is accompanied by congestive heart failure. In the rest of the three diseases, diuretics are not preferred when the hypertension is there. So hypertension with CHF, furosemide is preferred, because furosemide is a high saline diuretic, and it will cause the reduction in the preload or the pulmonary edema also, and that is more in the efficacious or more in the amount as compared to hydrochlorothiazide. Next question. Following antihypertensive drug has a favorable effect on plasma lipid profile. Answer is A, prazosin, which is a alpha 1 blocker. Rest these three, propranolol, hydrochlorothiazide and furosemide, they will cause dyslipidemia. So they will worsen the plasma lipid profile. They will increase the LDL level and they will decrease the HDL, which is harmful for the patient. So answer is prazosin, which has a favorable effect on plasma lipid profile. Following antihypertensive drug has been found to suppress certain manifestations of morphine withdrawal syndrome and to block the post-operative pain when injected intrathecally. The out of the available option, the answer is B, clonidine. It will be useful in morphine withdrawal as well as alcohol withdrawal patient, and it has also analgesic action, so can be useful to prevent the post-operative pain. Next, methyl dopa lowers the blood pressure. Now, methyl dopa is a central alpha 2 receptor, central sympatholytic or central alpha 2 receptor agonist. And by central alpha 2 receptor agonistic action, it will reduces the sympathetic tone. So, answer is B. It generates the alpha methyl noradrenaline. So, methyl dopa will be converted into alpha methyl noradrenaline in the brain, which will act on alpha 2 receptor and it will reduces the sympathetic tone. Okay. Some students may feel that C is answer, but this is nowadays it has been proved that central action by B is important, and this C, which is that alpha methyl noradrenaline acts as a false transmitter, is not proven through the researches. Following antihypertensive drug is used topically to treat alopecia areata. So the answer is here is a C, that is minoxidil. As we know, minoxidil increases the microcirculation in the hair follicles, so that's why it is also useful in the male pattern baldness, okay, apart from the antihypertensive effect. The ACE inhibitor which is useful in hypertensive emergencies is, the answer is enalaprilate. This is the active metabolite which is generated from enalapril. Enalapril is given by oral route, while enalaprilate is given for IV route for hypertensive emergencies. Next, a woman with 28th week of the pregnancy has developed pregnancy-induced hypertension with blood pressure 150 by 100. Select the most appropriate antihypertensive drug for her. The answer is here is B, methyl dopa, because rest 3-furosemide, that is diuretic propranolol, which is a non-selective cardiac blocker, and ACE inhibitor, they are teratogenic and should not be given to the pregnant female. So methyl dopa, you know, other drugs which can be given in the pregnant female are labetalol and hydralazine. A semi-conscious patient of hemorrhagic cerebral stroke has been brought to emergencies. His blood pressure is 240 by 120. Select the procedure to lower his blood pressure as rapidly as possible. Out of the available option, the C, that is intravenous infusion of sodium nitroprusside, is the correct answer, because sodium nitroprusside is a rapidly acting and it will reduce the blood pressure drastically by causing both venodilatation and arterial dilatation. While rest 3, nifedipine may be used, but because nifedipine also increases paroxysmal frequency of myocardial infarction, it is not preferred nowadays. Hydralazine and clonidine, they will take a time, so they are not useful for hypertensive emergencies. Diuretic acting on ascending limb of loop of Henle are the most efficacious in promoting the salt and water excretion, or they are also called high saline diuretics, like furosemide, which is acting on ascending limb, because reabsorptive capacity of the segment which is distal to it is limited. So the segments which are distal to ascending limb of loop of Henle, like distal tubule or collecting duct, a very little reabsorption is going to happen. So even if we are going to inhibit reabsorption there, we don't have that much effect. That's why the diuretics which are acting on ascending limb of loop of Henle, like furosemide or high saline diuretic, they are having a maximum efficacy or high saline efficacy. Following potassium sparing diuretic is also a mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. All these three ABC, they are potassium sparing diuretic, so they are preserving the potassium in the body. But spironolactone is acting by spironolactone is aldosterone antagonist or mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist. So answer is C. While amiloride and trimethoprim, though they are potassium sparing diuretic, they are acting by inhibition of renal epithelial sodium channel. Next, following drug is believed to improve microcirculation in peripheral vascular diseases by promoting RBC flexibility. This is an unusual question, but we have put for you. So answer is C, pentoxifilin. So it is called as a rheological modifier. It promotes RBC flexibility, and that's why it can be useful in intermittent claudication or peripheral vascular diseases to reduce that intermittent claudication related pain. Following drug is preferred for the termination as well as prophylaxis of paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia or PSVT. The answer is verapamil. Verapamil, yes, it is preferred for termination of acute attack of PSVT, as well as it is given for the prophylaxis or to prevent the recurrences of the PSVT. Okay. The last question, for treating the patient with CHF, which of the following doses of dopamine is selected for its positive inotropic action? This is a very tricky question commonly asked in the Viva. Answer here is B, 5 to 10 microgram per kg per minute, because at a dose of less than 2, it will act only on dopamine receptor, while act on a dose between 2 to 10 or 5 to 10, it will act mainly on beta 1 receptor and will increase the cardiac contractility. While at a doses of more than 10, it will act on alpha receptor and will cause vasoconstriction and increase in the blood pressure, which we don't want in the patient of CHF. That's why we have to keep the dose between 5 to 10. Answer is B. So thanks for your patience listening. Best of you already given the examination. So I think this will solve all your doubts. Thank you.